Well, this is a nice crowd. Are we giving away microwaves or what's going on here? I am, you know, they always write these notes for me, and it says, I want to welcome you to a discussion with former White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki. But I generally ignore these notes. And today I absolutely have to, because I am welcoming an old and dear friend. We've known each other for 15 years now. When I met her, I had hair, more hair. Hers may have been a different shade of red, I don't know. Yeah. But she was then a junior communications staffer on the Obama for President campaign. And even then, everyone knew that she was a star, everyone. Because she was so smart and so collected and so good with people. Within a couple of years, when we went to the White House, when Robert Gibbs left as press secretary, Jen was very much in contention for that job, which was remarkable given her age. And I think we've talked about this on the podcast. You didn't get the job. That was a disappointment. You didn't get it a second time. That was a disappointment. By the time you got it, you may have been the most qualified person ever to be the White House press secretary. And I would say, and I say this with great respect for all the people I know and people I don't who have held that job, no one has ever done it better than Jen Psaki. So. And before the other Jen Steinhauer, commences in this discussion, let me just make a few announcements. On Friday, May 20th, this Friday, I'll host a conversation about the midterm elections with former U.S. Senator Heidi Heitkamp, member of the Senior Advisory Board of the IOP, Cook Political Report publisher and editor-in-chief Amy Walter, also a member of the Senior Advisory Board of the IOP, and Republican, I guess still, where are you? Kind of Republican. Yeah, Republican-ish, she says. strategist and publisher of The Bulwark, Sarah Longwell, who's a fellow at the IOP now. And this discussion will take place at Mandel Hall, beginning at 3 p.m. On Monday, May 23rd, New York Times reporter Kate Zernicki will moderate a discussion about the potential post-Roe versus Wade America, which seems timely, with demographer Diana Green, Foster, University of Pittsburgh law professor Greer Donnelly, and pollster Teresa Undum. And that conversation will take place at the Quad Club at 5:30. And then on Tuesday, May 24th, Congressman Jamie Raskin will be in discussion with former U.S. Attorney General Eric Holder about the right to vote and the fight for it. That event will take place at the Quad Club, also at the Quad Club at 5:30. Finally, applications are opening for the Institute of Politics Project Battleground, a paid engagement opportunity. Project Battleground is a cohort-based program for students interested in working on campaigns in battleground states this summer on either side. Those looking to learn more can reach out to Mark Schauerty or attend an information session Thursday. Applications are due by Sunday, May 23rd. Where is the information session? At the IOP House. At what time?
6:30.
At 6:30. Okay. Keeping me on my toes here. And after tonight's moderated discussion, we'll open the floor to take questions from the audience. Please line up to ask your questions at the microphone, which I assume will be right there in the middle aisle. As usual, we'll give priority for the first questions to be asked by our students. As usual, they didn't put this in, but I will. Just remember that questions end in a question mark. And as a housekeeping note, please make sure your phones are on silent. And now, we'll hear formal introductions from Giuliano Rossi, a fourth-year political science major, originally from Los Angeles. Is that what this is? Giuliano currently serves as the comms chair for the IOP's Student Advisory Board it really totally understates her role at the IOP, which has been prodigious and for which we're really, really grateful. Next year, she'll be attending Georgetown for her master's in foreign service, which you will applaud as a former State Department spokesperson.
Sure. Not an easy place to get into.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, they choose wisely. Mm-hmm. Please join me in welcoming Juliana to the podium. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us for tonight's IOP Speaker Series event, Notes from the Frying Pan to the Fire. My name is Juliana Rossi, and I'm a fourth year in the college majoring in political science. I currently serve as the communications co-chair of the IOP Student Advisory Board. As a woman in communications aspiring towards a future career in politics, it is my honor tonight to introduce our guest, former White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki. Ms. Psaki joined the Biden-Harris transition team in 2020 and addressed the press from the White House podium through some of the most pivotal moments in recent American history. As White House Press Secretary, Ms. Psaki served as the public face of the Biden administration and spoke on issues from COVID-19 to the American withdrawal from Afghanistan. Prior to joining the Biden-Harris administration, Ms. Psaki served as White House Communications Director during the Obama administration, serving as a leading force in media operations and public narratives for the Obama presidency. Prior to this, she served as spokesperson for the Department of State. Her first foray into the White House came in 2008, as she served as traveling press secretary for President Barack Obama's groundbreaking campaign and was later promoted to Deputy Communications Director after his election. She's also served as a political commentator on CNN. Ms. Psaki's poise behind the podium and commitment to integrity and civility makes her a role model for women in leadership everywhere. Moderating tonight's discussion is Jennifer Steinhauer, Director of the Speaker Series Program here at the Institute of Politics. Thank you all again for joining us, and please join me in giving a warm welcome to Jen Psaki.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Hi, Jen.
Hi.
Welcome to Chicago.
Thank you. It's a huge pleasure to be here. Let me start by saying that. And this is the first thing I'm doing since I left the White House. A lot of things to get off my chest.
Oh, awesome. You came for the weather, no doubt.
Yes.
So I'm just going to get this out of the way. We're just going to do the doozy.
Okay.
Whether people follow politics, didn't follow politics, the country was sort of mesmerized by these weekly or often more than that sparring that you had mm-hmm. with the Fox News reporter in the briefing room. Some people think that you hate each other. Some people think you secretly have brunch. There's like all these different theories. But you left with what seemed to be this measured mutual respect that you both expressed. So I'm curious, it kind of became sort of this almost metaphor for the media era that we're living in, right? So I'm curious, what was your true role of those moments in the briefing room, and what was your approach there?
Sure. First, let me say that I do like Peter Doocy, and that may not be popular with everybody. That's okay. But part of the objective when I came into this job was to reestablish civility in the briefing room and make it a place where people could hear information through the media to the public, not a place where there wasn't debate and tough questioning. Actually, when that is happening, in my view, that's when it's working, and that's an important part of our democracy, not just in the United States, but it's also a message we're sending to the world. This is not a common thing that other countries do, where there's three briefings nearly every day that happen in the U.S. government. So we made a decision from the beginning that part of restoring civility was treating people with respect in the briefing room, to calling on everyone, including Fox, which didn't always have positive reporting about the president or the vice president, and not making a dispute with Fox the story. And there are times when that may be appropriate, but not when you follow an administration where they were disputing the legitimacy of institutions or the media. And so, we began a lot of these sparring. It became sparring because he would ask questions. He wrote the questions a lot of times. Sometimes I'm sure they were worked out with people he worked with at Fox. They represented what Fox was talking about on that day. And you could sometimes often predict what they might be, right? It skewed a lot more about immigration and the border and the vice president and all sorts of things that may not have always been, they wanted to make into a controversy. But I will say at the end of the day, we did not brunch. But we also didn't hate each other. It was somewhere in between. What I will say is that we had a civil, good relationship, I will say. What I will say is there is a good question to be posed. Maybe someone will pose this. Well, not. I'll pose it for you. We had a good relationship. We had a sparring in the briefing room. Is that performative? Maybe it is, right? And what does it say about the fact that we had that back and forth in the briefing room? And on social media, I was cheered for pushing back on Peter Doocy, and he was cheered for pushing back on me. And in many ways, as much as we had a civil, good, professional relationship, that does speak to kind of the division in society and what social media does and drives. That was a long answer. I'll try to make them shorter, but proceed.
It's okay. And we'll get back to the social media piece as it pertains to you especially. But as David alluded to, you know, you had to have been one of the most prepared White House press secretaries, just given your many experiences in the podium at state and the White House traveling and so forth. Over that course of time, what would you say became the thing that you were least prepared for? What has changed so much that it was no longer applicable in your job?
That's such a good question. I know we're going to talk about social media, but it is part of what has changed over time. Even back to when I was coming in to the press office and working for then Robert Gibbs, who was the press secretary, I don't think I had a Twitter account at the time as one of the deputy press secretaries. And I remember coming back as the communications director. Now this is 2015, and we had a whole set of meetings. This is very quaint when you think back to the last few years, about whether or not the president should have his own personal Twitter account or not, whether that was presidential or not. This was literally the conversation. We decided he should because it's a means of communicating with the public. But it has changed a lot of things, and Twitter is an enormous driver of what happens in the briefing room. And what is concerning about that is that Twitter is only about 20% of the public. It's very coastal, it's very white, it's very liberal. And about 10% of the tweets or 90% of the tweets are about from 10% of the people on Twitter. So point is, what has changed is that is this entity which you very much engage with if you're doing press and communications in the White House or the government or what have you, but it is an oversized driver of what happens, and it is a contributor to the having conversations with ourselves and not having conversations with about topics that the public cares about.
Well, just to pick up on that a little bit, and I swear we're not going to talk about Twitter the whole time here, but something that came up on a stage here recently was this notion that we don't really have kind of these high-profile political operatives anymore, like Karl Rove, like David Axelrod, Kellyanne Conway, I would say, in that category, kind of in the spotlight. And so in this dynamic that you're describing, you've sort of kind of in some ways became the personification of the administration. And that's whether it was kind of like the yes queen aspect of it or, you know, all the other things we just described. Did that feel weird for you? Do you feel like that's part of this culture shift? What was that like for you personally?
For me personally, so because of COVID, and you know, I did not go out anywhere for a long time, as I'm sure it's true for many people in here. And when I started this job, I don't think I left the White House for the first 2 or 3 months. Actually, I remember the first time I tried to leave the White House, and I had worked there before, but I couldn't figure out how to wave the badge to get out of the gate, and it was like shaking the gate and trying to get out to get a cup of coffee. But my point is, the briefing room is very small, and so when you are just doing that every day, and you're doing your job, and you're trying to do your job, you're pretty closed off from kind of the external stuff, aside from Twitter, and I won't focus on that. And the first time that I was out in public and anyone recognized me for good, I had somebody who followed me around and was yelling shame at me at a baseball game, and my husband was very distressed by this. I was not. And then I also had people who wanted to take pictures. And it was very jarring because I had just been doing my job and had not been tracking that anyone would ever possibly know who I was. So that was jarring. What has been the most difficult is that there are a lot of people out there who are vitriolic, and I've had a lot of threats against me, against my family, names of my kids texted to me with my home address, things that are very scary. And that is when it starts to get, I don't know, was that the case 10, 15, 20 years ago? I'm not sure, but it is an aspect of today that is a little scarier. And truth is, I can go out there. I mean, last week I was in this job 5 or 6 days ago, and you know, I had a lot to say about Senator Rick Scott's tax plan, right? I don't wish him ill, right? I don't wish violence against him or his family. I wish him fine. I wish him well, you know? I just disagree with his tax plan. And we're now at a point in time where it is frightening, the level of vitriol out there. And as a weirdly a semi-public-ish person, that is something that has been a part I didn't anticipate.
And I think I read that you said that you even had to involve the Secret Service sometimes.
I've had to report a number of things to them over the course of time, yes, because you don't know what's accurate and what's not accurate. And I have like no risk aversion, but my husband, who fortunately has a higher level than I do, it becomes alarming when your kids' names are out there and your home address is out there and you're getting threatening mail to your house. You do have to be proactive about it.
Right. I want to kind of pivot from that a little bit into politics and policy.
Yeah.
So, you know, you came up in that 2007-8 Obama world.
Yeah.
With a candidate who saw himself as transformational, and he would always speak about the fever breaking on these moments. I think that's kind of been asked and answered.
Yeah.
And then Joe Biden fashioned himself as this return to a less partisan time when his power was about persuasion and compromise with both parties. And we've seen what's gone on there. He's not been terribly successful in wooing Republicans. He can't even really get members of his own party, especially like Joe Manchin, on board to do the big things. Can you reflect on that? And it's somewhat in context of what we're talking about, but broader, over this in a more longitudinal way. In essence, from your view, what has happened that you've seen from both sides of the podium to our culture and our politics that's made this way?
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot to say about this. I'm sure people have a lot of thoughts in this room. I will say, as you were asking me this, one of the art pieces I was thinking about, which I reckon it's now several years old, but it just reminds me of the end of the Obama administration, was this very long piece that Ta-Nehisi Coates wrote for The Atlantic. And if anyone's read it, when he was working on this speech, it's long, and it was about whether we'd made progress on race in our country through the prism of the Obama presidency. Now, when he was starting to write this, he was it was hopeful, right? He had a bunch of conversations with the president. And, you know, he as anybody who's read his writing, he is a skeptic by nature, and I say that in a complimentary way. It's kind of part of his appeal. But the end of the piece was very sad because it was this feeling, naively, like we'd made this massive change in our country. And actually, maybe we had, maybe we hadn't, maybe maybe things have some ups and downs. I think there's a lot of things that have contributed to it. What I would say for this president and the last president I worked for is neither of them think today that change would happen overnight or in a straight line or over the course of 12, 15, 16, 48 direct months. And what we've maybe seen over the last couple of years, in my view, is maybe the worst, maybe not the worst, but kind of what happens when people get to go to their sides and you need to kind of regroup and have a conversation about exactly this. I wouldn't say, and I don't work for him or speak for him anymore, but, you know, sometimes this question of whether you're successful on a bipartisan basis is thought about, like, whether you can convince Joe Manchin to do something or a set number of Republicans in Washington. I don't know that it's entirely that. It is partly that, of course. Now, there were 80 bills that were bipartisan signed into law last year. That's not nothing, including the infrastructure bill. But it is also about the country and whether you can get people to have a conversation with each other and have a civil conversation about areas they disagree. And that is something that prompting the country to do that and people in their communities is also hard. And I don't think there's been success at that entirely either, but that's an important part of it.
But at the same time, right, this is a tough time for President Biden with his own party.
Mm-hmm.
You've seen his poll numbers. There's this great sense of disappointment, among Democrats about what hasn't gotten done, that the message feels insufficient to the moment. Why aren't the gloves come off? Why isn't the messaging more refined? What about just within your own party? Did President Biden overpromise during his campaign? What's going on?
I don't believe that overpromising during a campaign is a thing, to be honest. Campaigns are aspirational. You are projecting what you hope the country will be. Does everybody reach every single thing? Not necessarily, right? I mean, he's 15 months, 16 months into his first term in office. He's got more time to get things done. Were there disappointments? Yeah, of course there were, right? I mean, as we know, there was a reconciliation package, Build Back Better, right? That there was some element of agreement on that obviously hasn't moved forward. That's disappointment. What do you learn from that? You learn some things like not putting the spotlight on the negotiations of just Congress and instead going out and communicating with the public. You've seen him do some more of that. You also learn that while coming in, and this is an interesting question because a lot of this, what this question raises, is the debates you have within a White House, right? In the first year, we're trying to create stability again, to make sure there is discourse that is positive and constructive. In that time, can you go attack the former president and Republicans? We tried not to do that too much, right? Now, in retrospect, was that the right decision? I don't know. It's hard to make that evaluation looking back. But what is true is that now that it's campaign season, I think everybody can expect, and you've already seen this, more of the current of President Biden contrasting with Republicans. You've seen him talk about ultra MAGA, the MAGA kink. Sometimes he's like riffing about things and adding things that are of his own flavor, which is good. And that contrast is actually what people make decisions about. And typically, hopefully for him, will have an impact on the polls.
So that just leads me to have to ask, and I'm sort of inferring from what you say, but candidly now you don't speak for him anymore. Is he still the man for this moment? Should he run again?
Yeah, I think you should. Okay. And he's planning on it.
And I guess the only other thing I would say about that is, again, these tough times that happen toward the end of your tenure, I'm sure that there are moments it's hard not to take that personally or to feel that personally. Can you describe that at all, what's like when you see these poll numbers or you're taking a beating every day during the time of the withdrawal in Afghanistan, the toughest moments?
Yeah.
What was that like for you?
I mean, the withdrawal from Afghanistan was the hardest period of time when I was in the White House for a range of reasons. One was obviously we lost 13 soldiers. That's devastating, heartbreaking, heart-wrenching. These are families who have lost their loved ones and people who served the country. It's the worst day by far that I had in the White House. And I was there in the Situation Room when they were learning of the attack and were getting updates on how many people's lives have been lost. And it doesn't matter how many times you've done it. I mean, I've worked there before, but you sat there at the table with people who'd worked in government for decades, and people were holding back tears. Of course they were. It was a very difficult day. Now, days like that, you also see heartbreak, and you see, in many ways, the best of people, too, because people have to pick themselves up, and they have to move on, and they have to continue leading the rest of the soldiers who are trying to get more people out of Afghanistan and trying to deliver on the president's decision to withdraw from Afghanistan after a 20-year failed war. And you see people pick themselves up, and you see people get up the next day and make decisions in the Situation Room about how to balance the protection of our troops and also trying to evacuate tens of thousands of people. In those moments, what I benefited from in this job is that having served there before, I started this job and I thought to myself, I'm gonna smell the roses more than last time. You know, I'm gonna sit there and I'm gonna take in moments of history that I'm observing. I also have seen and been there for almost everything in the past. Now, every new tragedy is slightly different, right? Or every new crisis is slightly different. But when you've seen all these things, you're a bit more stable, right? And unwavering, unflappable, because you have the experience of living through it before. And you don't have a choice in the White House. You have to kind of, the day that we lost these 13 soldiers was also the day of my daughter's kindergarten open house. And I remember thinking, I can't miss this open house. This is like the biggest thing that's ever happened in her 5 years of life, right? I have to go. I'm not gonna tell people I'm going because it just didn't feel right. Basically snuck out of the White House, went to the open house, celebrated the book corner and the pencils and everything. And then I went back to the White House. And I thought to myself, how am I gonna do this mentally, right? Because it's such a switch from this devastation and sadness and then celebrating the beginning of excitement, school, right? I will say that that was probably one of the best briefings I did that day because I had that moment of restabilizing myself with my family, reconnecting with people, my family, and it helped me to hopefully meet that moment, a moment that was incredibly heartbreaking and devastating in the White House and to the country.
Let's talk a little bit more about that you've just surfaced, because I saw a photograph recently of all your staff, and it's very striking how female it is, right? And I know there's young women, and I've heard through the grapevine that there's a lot of candid conversations about work life and balance. You have a lot of young women in this office,
yeah,
in this room right now, who are contemplating difficult careers in public service, who are wondering what the model is for that now. How important was that for you to set a specific tone under your tenure? And frankly speaking, how much did having two very young children factor into your decision to leave after 15 months?
On the last part, he was a huge factor. Mm-hmm. If I didn't have kids, I might still be there. Mm-hmm. The president can fire you at any time, so who knows? But like, you know, I would probably still be there. For me, this was a huge honor to serve at this moment in time, in part because of the small role I could play in hopefully rebuilding trust with the public and with the press and with the media. And, you know, you don't do that as one person. You don't do that as one team. You don't do that in 1 year. But I saw it that way. And I never expected to be there. So it was all of the experience was icing on the cake to me. When I was coming up in press and communications, I mean, I'm not like 100, so I'm still got like more years to work. But like, when I was coming up in it, I didn't know, when I was 6 months pregnant when I went back to the White House to be the communications director. I was talking about this earlier today. And when Dennis McDonough, who was then the White House chief of staff, called me about this, I don't know if you've ever had this experience as a reporter, and I'm gonna ask you questions, but like, but when he called me, I was pregnant, and I thought to myself, oh, he doesn't know I'm pregnant. Okay, I'm gonna tell him I'm pregnant. And he's saying to me, I want you to come back. The president wants you to come back and be the communications director. And then when I tell him I'm pregnant, he's gonna say, good luck with everything, you know? Well, good luck, it's great. He didn't say that. I mean, he said, that's great, we'll figure it out. Now, I had to say I need maternity leave. I had to say that I have to leave at 5:30. I had to work out some of my own things here because there wasn't really a model for this, and there wasn't a lot. I'm sure there were people, I just didn't know who they were, like who had had babies and like worked at high jobs in government. Now, after I did it, you find those people or they find you or what have you, but it's not very obvious. So it was important to me in this job, when I started this job, to hire women, to hire a very diverse team of people, to kind of figure out how you could bring up kind of new faces and new people to be a part of leadership in government and leadership in press and communications. If anybody who worked for me was here, hopefully they wouldn't tell you any terrible stories, I don't know, they would tell you that I am like a pusher of having a family, of not calling in when you're on vacation, of all these things, because I think that sending that message as a boss, that is okay, is vitally important. Otherwise, people will not do it who work for you in the White House. And we tried to create an environment where that was okay. And that was an important part of, and actually an exciting part of this opportunity to me too, was like working with people who were in their 20s and early 30s who I didn't know before. And now I know all these kind of amazing rising stars in politics and government, and that's been a really cool part of the job.
And there's still that feeling, though, of having to sneak off, right? That you can't always be completely open with those people.
Yeah, this is a very important thing, is that people, this whole notion of having it all, that's like not really a thing in my experience. I mean, you have to make choices about what you're going to do and for how long you're going to do it, and at what stages in your career. And I made a choice, to your point. I was going to do this job for a year, which turned into 15 months, which is fine, because I wanted to be there for my kids. Now, I could say to the president, or the last president I worked for, I can't be at this meeting on Saturday because my kids have a soccer game. And they would say, fine, no problem. But then the problem is you miss the meeting, and you want to be in the meeting, and you want to be at the table to make decisions and be a part of the conversation. So the challenge of the oversimplified you can have it all is it's not acknowledging you're going to have to make choices, and you can make choices throughout your career. The last thing I will say on this is that I also felt it was important to remember that in my experience, I had a lot of women elbowing me sharply. I will be honest here. I did not want to be that woman, and I want other women to not be that woman, including who are in their 30s and 20s today. Now, I've also had amazing female mentors. It is not that, but it is not that if there were more women, everything would be great. That is not solving all the problems, unfortunately. And I would also say that, and Axe just walked out here, but you know, I have had my best mentors have been men. And that in part is because of the industry I'm in, politics. It just is how it is sometimes. They have helped me along the way. And if I limited and said, I will only have mentors who are women, I will only mentor women, I would be limiting myself and I would be limiting the people who I engage with. And so that's just the other piece of advice I would give to the students here about how you look at and perceive what's next for you. Don't limit yourself so much. It doesn't have to work exactly that way.
Right, that's an important distinction. I'm glad you made that. So your brand is officially Cool Cucumber.
Oh, boy.
But there were times, I think. You acknowledged this.
I am an Irish lass.
Yes, like you said, I think you referred to it as showing your Irish side.
Yes.
So were there any of those moments you might regret?
Sure. First of all, I regret probably every day something I didn't say. Or
well,
I should have said
say.
More clearly.
Right.
Or I should have said more clearly or more context I would have given. And I said this on my last day, but this is very true, is that I learned a lot. And became better at my job because of the reporters in the briefing room. And there were some days where you came out and you're like, oh my God, I can't believe they asked about that. Fine, okay, you have days like that. But most days you come out and you would say to yourself, I wish I knew more about that, or that was a really interesting way that question was asked, or we need more on that for tomorrow. And that is in some ways that behind the scenes aspect, I think, is how democracy and that give and take with the media should work, right? Maybe you have the answer, hopefully you have the answer. If not, you're gonna go get more information and you're gonna come back and have more information better later that day or the next day. It's not that everything exactly works that way, but there are certainly times nearly every day where I regret. Some specifics, back in December, this is not a good excuse, but I'll just take you behind the scenes.
Please.
That I had the honor of going and attending the Kennedy Center Honors, which went until 1 a.m, which is an outrageous time in my view. No one should be awake at that hour.
You're at a college campus.
I know,
anyway,
I'm saying that so you all think I'm not cool at all. But I, and the next day I was very tired, and when I'm tired, sometimes the Irish comes out. And it was a day where we were explaining our testing capacity, if you remember this period of time. And I had answered, if for anybody who would have watched the whole briefing, which nobody watches the whole briefing, especially in the age of social media, for about 30 minutes, I explained in intricate detail everything we were doing to expand the market, make sure we had enough tests, make them free, all the things we were doing. And I answered that question about 8 times. Finally got to the 9th person, and she asked a question. It was like, I'd had enough. And my answer was like a little snarky, not how I like to engage with people. And of course, that became the whole meme and the whole thing. And so, yeah, I regret that. I early on did not know about the Space Force. I regret that. I will say what they did. And sometimes, you know, the Space Force came, well, not all of them, but some of them came, and they gave me a Space Force pin and a very lovely note. I now, of course, know what the Space Force is, but early on, I don't know, that wasn't my primary focus. So there are, of course, many moments nearly every day.
There's a lot of people in the Pentagon who don't know what the Space Force is.
I think
you should feel okay about that.
That may be true.
And on the flip side of that, you did allude to someone, you know, thinking that's the dumbest question I've ever heard. So did you have names, news organization, time, dates that happened?
The Space Force thing?
No.
Oh.
Worst question you were ever asked.
Oh, God, yes. I was asked by the New York Post, I'm more than happy to call them out, whether or not I could commit to not euthanizing the president's dog. That was literally a question one day. Whether I would commit to not killing the president's dog. It was not necessarily a hard question, but it was a question one day.
You could commit, though? I don't know.
I could commit to not killing the president's dog. I looked at him for a minute and I thought, okay.
I think we all feel good about that commitment, though.
Yeah, I think so.
So, disinformation, the topic du jour. We know we had former President Obama here for a conference about that topic a few weeks ago. And he made a comment that was very interesting. He suggested he had some regrets about not perhaps taking disinformation as seriously as he could have at different points in his tenure. And some people in the room inferred that he might have been referring to 2016 in the election. So looking back and with candor, Do you think he and others in the administration should have been more vocal what they understood to be going on? And do you think, frankly speaking, that there might not have been as much speaking out or warning because there was this sense that Hillary Clinton's win was a fait accompli?
So yes, I think that, and I don't know what he was referring to, but I assume that was a part of it. I do think that we could have, and all of us could have, up and down the chain there, done better in 2016. I don't think, some of it may have been, but the totality of it was not because of an assumption of Hillary Clinton's win. I'll come back to that. A big part of it was the assumption that, well, one, the use of social media to spread disinformation by the Russians was classified at the time and was only known by a handful of people. I didn't know about it. Josh Earnest, who was the press secretary, didn't know about it. We were all focused on the electoral threat, I mean the threat to voting machines, of the Russians changing voting machines. And that was what the focus was on. We did all these calls with secretaries of state and others in a bipartisan fashion to have a discussion about that. Looking back, we were naive about the impact of social media and how it was impacting. And certainly the people who knew about it weren't thinking of it as the type of threat that we know it to be today. It is also true that there was a calculation looking back that if we went out and said that disinformation, you know, they could be trying to rig the election for Hillary Clinton, that her opponent, who became president, could have said this election is rigged after it was over, after she won. And that was our assumption of what the outcome was going to be, right? They could try to fiddle with the machines, she would win, because everybody thought that at the time, and after she won, he would say, this is rigged, and it would be a long-standing battle hurting the transition in the beginning of her presidency. So hindsight is always 20/20, but there's no question that things could have been done better, they could have been shared more aggressively. Now, if they were shared with the public, would it have changed things? It's very hard to know that. But I think if that were to happen again, which it will be, they infiltrate, they try to hack every election. Talking about it publicly would certainly, I assume, be the playbook.
That's interesting. You talk about it being classified. It's not the same thing, obviously, but we saw that the Pentagon did release some classified information about what was going on in Ukraine. And that was kind of shocking in the moment and considered, and even in question and considered a good thing. I mean, do you see those as kind of parallel things? Or?
Totally. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were a lot of people who were there back in 2016, or not, or who were there beforehand. You know, Bill Burns, the CIA director, he wasn't there in 2016, but he was prior to that, the Deputy Secretary of State. Avril Haines was in the was on the National Security Team. She's now the DNI, Director of National Intelligence. So there's no question that that experience, and also I would argue probably 2014 and what the Russians did to spread propaganda and disinformation in Europe, some in the U.S., but a lot of it successfully through Europe at the time when the Russians invaded Ukraine, definitely impacted. It's not always easy to get information declassified, and so the fact that all of these people on the national security team currently decided to do that is very significant, and it was criticized initially. For threatening sources and methods, like, you know, how people get information and what sources they go about, or people who are sources in some of these places. But the objective of that, which has been effective to date, was to basically call out the Russians for the type of actions and behavior or tactics they were going to use. Does it stop them entirely? No. Does it prevent them from being able to control their public because they're basically controlling information? No. But what it does do is it better educates the global media, Europe, Americans about these type of tactics and disinformation and what people should look out for, and educates the public on it. So in some ways, I actually think it's like another reason why, if this sort of thing were had to happen here again, that that playbook would be important.
So the playbook's changing then?
Yeah.
It is.
As it needed to after 2016.
Okay. I want to go back to something you alluded to in the beginning, and you talked about this on your last day on the podium, too. You talked about pretty emotionally about going to meet with President Biden.
I know. Dr. I cried Biden. A lot during my last 2 weeks. It was just not really my deal. It was just emotional.
Yeah. I wouldn't say it was over a lot in that particular moment. It was, you know, marginal medium crying.
Yes.
But you talked about the fact that you, when you went to speak to them in Delaware, I believe it was, The goal was to return integrity, respect, and civility to the White House, and you've alluded to that many times since then. And you talked about that at the top when we were talking about your exchanges with Fox News. But can you talk a little more deeply about that? What did, because you were emotional speaking about that, and I'm curious what that meant to you when you thought about your goals when you started the job. How central was that to them, and how did that manifest?
I'm not sure in the moment I was emotional about that particular piece. I was thinking about leaving the White House and leaving this amazing team and not seeing the president every day, which, yes, it's not having like access to the Oval Office. I guess it's that, but I really like him as a person. You know, it's probably more that. You know, I think this was part of my objective more than I think most people who have had this job in the past, because the engagement between the press office and the briefing room and the press office and the media, and frankly, the last White House and the media, was diminishing respect and the credibility of institutions and the media, and really putting into question what is truth, what is accurate. Now, there are moments in there which are political and partisan, and that's part of it too. You could argue that's truth or not, or that's spin or whatever, but I think the what we tried to do, or what I tried to do on my best days and instilled in my team it was important to do, is find ways to tell the story with facts and details and specifics, with graphs, with the not political people, but the policy experts. We brought more policy experts into that briefing room in the last year than they've probably ever done it before. They don't come in there, the CA director does not come in there and talk about politics. In fact, she kind of freaks out if there's politics. That's, you know, a line of questioning. Or the National Security Advisor or others. Because bringing to light who's making the policy, why the policy is being made, what the decisions are, acknowledging when something is hard or not decided or can't happen for a variety of reasons, I think was part of what was important at the time.
And you're alluding to all the specifics of things you will miss. What are things you won't miss?
I would say I will not miss news stories that break on Saturday nights or Sunday nights or times where you're trying to spend time with family. It's really hard. You can never turn it off, right? You can never turn it off. So you kind of would wake up with a cold sweat, whatever it is, in the morning and not know what happened on your phone overnight. There's always something, right? And it's very hard to be present with your kids, with your friends, with your family. It's just you don't have the bandwidth to be present, even if your phone is not going off. So I will not miss that. I will not miss, the president will watch this, so it's okay, I think, but there's something called remarks review, where you go through remarks, and it is like this very lengthy process. And I'm looking at the former mayor up here, and I'm wondering if she did this to her team, and I don't know. It is, sometimes it can be an hour or more where you're just walking through remarks that are going to be given that day or the next day. It's important, but it is a lot of time, and it's a lengthy process I won't miss.
So that was less than scintillating, and your message to all elected officials is don't do that.
Well, my message to elected officials would probably be that giving pre-written remarks should be saved for moments where that's vitally important to deliver, and to be more creative about how you communicate with the public.
Wow. Okay. So you talked about the worst day. What was the second worst day?
Oh, boy. Such a good question. I would say probably one of the days I had to announce I had COVID. I had it twice. And, you know, I'll say the first one, because the first one was last October. Now it feels like everybody's kind of had COVID. I don't know. Back then it didn't feel that way. And this kind of goes back to the privacy piece. My kids had it first, and I had to announce, I didn't announce they had it because I was protecting their privacy, but I had to announce I had a family emergency because I couldn't go on this foreign trip, right?
Right.
And so it starts to get borderline self-admitted, I did it to myself. Violating a little bit of your family and personal privacy when you're kind of saying that because people are wondering what's going on. Then when I had COVID, everybody knew, 5 days later, everybody knew my kids had COVID. And so But that day, I don't know if it was the worst, but it was one of the, because it's kind of putting yourself out there as something happening with your family, and that's a part of it I didn't really anticipate. I will note a funny thing now that I can look back on that period of time. The second time I had COVID, we had to hold the press plane so that the president could get tested. And I had to make sure I had not given him COVID. So that was also not great. I was also sitting on my porch. But the funny part about the first time is then everybody knew my kids had had COVID. So I showed up at birthday parties for my kids, and I was like, do I just like say something about it on the front end? Or, you know, so I started to be like, Sally, so nice to you. I know you know they had COVID. I'm just going to like break the ice, you know, because it's like very public that my whole family had COVID. So, yeah, there were probably other terrible, challenging days, but those are some of the ones I remember.
COVID, the great birthday party icebreaker. So, what about your best day?
I would say one of my best days was the day that now Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson did her event at the White House. And it was because you have so many days in the White House that are exhausting, that are heartbreaking, that feel like maybe you don't have all the information or all the answers. And that day was just a day of pure joy. And I hadn't thought about the day a lot because it just kind of was happening. It was on the schedule. She was doing an event. I actually didn't think it would be quite an emotional day. I thought it'd be cool. But I remember sitting outside and bawling. Everybody was crying. And I looked around. I was crying and I was thinking, should I be crying right now? And then I looked around like everybody's crying. And her speech was, if anybody hasn't watched it, you should watch it. It was, if you like her, of course. But it was amazing. And it was just, and it was one of those days where you remember, wow, I'm a part of this. Like, I'm a part of this woman becoming a Supreme Court justice. And that is so cool. No matter how many long days or long hours or Saturday night calls to editors, which is, that's my least favorite. That was my, you know, that's not my favorite part. So that was probably one of my best days. Also the day the Olympics team came, because I'm obsessed with the Olympics. And
I
dove into the Olympians. And I think they were like, this is crazy. But that was also another great day.
That sounds not bad. just on the performative thing really quick, I want to return to that because I told you that I would.
Yeah.
Mike McCurry, one of Clinton's press secretaries, yeah, you know,
famously
lamented, yeah, opening the daily press briefings to cameras.
Yeah.
Saying it had been kind of less substantive, more performative. Mm-hmm. Given we talked about at the top, do you think cameras should be turned off in there? Is that even possible at this point?
It's a good question. Now, if Hillary Clinton had won, and we were thinking, because we were planning for that, and we were thinking about what advice we would give to her incoming press and communications team, we would have told them, don't do an on-camera briefing every day. I mean, be available, do briefings, do gaggles, do whatever. There's all sorts of ways to do it, but you could readjust. Do some with regional reporters, do some with reporters who are only doing digital reporting. Diversify what you do, because it's outdated. It's vitally important, and I think vitally important at this moment in time. And this is what we decided we needed to do it 5 days a week because what we were following, and we needed to kind of reestablish that cadence and that ability and that back and forth and that, you know, healthy debate. But I do think it could use some updating and thinking about ways you can still make sure you're answering tough questions, being there to have that debate, making sure you're bringing policy experts forward, while not making it kind of a daily performance, would probably be a good thing.
And you think you'll take these points of view into your new job? I mean, or do you think you'll feel sorry for the press secretary? How do you think you'll be in that kind of table turn?
Well, I don't have anything to say about what I'm going to be doing next at this point. However, I will say that I will always have sympathy. I mean, I think public servants are remarkable. And I think that there are a lot of public servants. Actually, the ones who are the most remarkable are probably the people you don't know, you know? And this is the truth of it. And this is what I had the ability to see through my time in working in government. And you know this, a lot of other people know this here. Now, I remember the day that we were negotiating this chemical weapons deal with Russia, which fell apart, whatever, it's not an important moment in history necessarily at this moment. But what I remember about that day is I was working at the State Department, and we had to go very quickly to Europe to do these negotiations. And I said to one of my colleagues, does anyone know anything about chemical weapons? Like, how do we find these people? And they were like, oh, yes. There's 25 chemical weapons experts or something like that in the State Department. And I use that example because you don't know who they are. They could be wandering around the campus right now. You don't know. But they're remarkable. They have this incredible expertise. And my value for public servants, people who speak publicly or otherwise, is very positive. I don't see DC as this place that's like corrupt and everything's negative and terrible. It is not House of Cards. It's a little Veep, it's a little Veep. There's a lot of Jonas everywhere. They're everywhere in DC. But there's a lot of West Wing about it, you know? And I think this job reinvigorated for me and reinstilled in me this belief that, you know, like working with and engaging with all these people who are in their 20s and 30s gave me huge hope for the future and the future of public service, the future of government, the future of democracy. And so, you know, I'll always have like a, you know, a good place even if I'm asking hard questions.
We'll tell the college students about West Wing later.
Some of them asked me about it earlier. Oh, so.
You yeah. Chicago.
But they know Jonah.
Yes.
Yes.
To say they know Jonah's here too.
Yes.
So everyone should start getting ready to ask questions. We're going to move to that. I'm just going to ask you one really quick one. It could be yes or no, but
okay.
Everyone should go ahead and line up. And as we said, of course, we give our priority to students. So let's just go back to the Wayback Machine one last time. President Obama,
yeah.
2004 convention speech, launched his career.
Yeah.
He famously said, there is not a liberal America and a conservative America.
Yeah.
There is the United States of America.
Yeah.
There's not a black America and a white America, a Latino America and an Asian America. There's the United States of America.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if that resonated with you at the time, and if you can say in your heart, is that true today?
It definitely did. Like many people, that was the speech that made me want to work for him when he was running for president. My husband, he was my boyfriend at the time, he was a Biden supporter in 2007, which I've told the president many times. And when I went to work for then candidate Senator Obama, we had just started dating, and he said to me, it'll be over in a few months. He was obviously wrong. I'm gonna remind him of this until we're 80, so just for the record. I still believe that, and here's why. I do think that maybe in some ways, because that was beautiful speech and a beautiful, it oversimplified some things, maybe, but when I think about the country and the people I've engaged with, and I've benefited a lot from working on political campaigns and being around the country and not always just being in Washington, or even talking to my neighbors in Virginia. I mean, I live right outside of Washington, but my neighbors are, many of them are Republicans, some are Democrats, some aren't political. I don't believe everybody fits into kind of a clean category of you're either this iteration of the party or you're this iteration of the party. My belief is actually that most people are a mix. You know, maybe you own a gun at your house, but you very much believe that labor unions are important and vital to our society. Maybe you didn't like the Supreme Court choices. But, you know, you are very pleased that, President Biden is trying to fight for lowering the cost of childcare. I actually think those are the conversations more than what we sometimes oversimplify things to be. Not with everybody. I recognize there are a lot of people who feel firmly that they have to check every box on one side or another. But I'm a believer that there's a lot more of gray. We are a lot more gray than most people are. Then we are fully one or the other. So therefore, I do think that we are one America and that we have to have hope about what the future brings and what it brings forward. And the last thing I'll say is I was a fellow, not here, at the Little Brother, Little Sister program at Georgetown University. And I will tell you that one of the other fellows I worked with was this guy by the name of Tony Saya, who there's no reason you would necessarily know, but he worked for Trump. And he ran public affairs at the Treasury Department after I worked with him as a fellow. And he and I became, he was actually my closest friend in the fellows class. We became buddies. And right now, I've been very public about all the things I disagree with about Trump, so it's not necessarily about that. But Tony and I have stayed in touch. I poke him when I disagree with things. He pokes me. He will never attack me, I don't think. I will never attack him. And that was my own experience just from doing a program similar to this in some ways, and maybe an extreme version of it. I mean, that was before the Trump presidency, but still, he's somebody I knew as a human being. And I don't mean to be overly Pollyanna-ish or optimistic, but I do believe, you know, that for me was an example of how, you know, civility can happen. We'll see, because I know there may be people who don't like me in here or disagree with me. That's okay.
We'll find out. Step right
Come
up.
On forward.
Hi, I'm Annie Henderson. I'm a master's student at the Public Policy School. Really excited to meet CJ Craig in real life.
Oh, good. Thank you
so
for that.
I am old enough to know West Wing. My question is, there's a lot of criticism of Democrats that they're bad at messaging, good at policy, bad at messaging. And I'm curious, as one of the most prominent Democratic communicators, do you agree with that? And as we're going in to the midterms, what advice do you have for Democratic candidates who are trying to message the public?
Yeah. Not every Democrat's bad at messaging, I'll say. But I think there are a couple things that Democrats could do better collectively, for sure. I mean, one is, and President Biden says it, but he's not the first who said it, the key with politics is don't compare me to the Almighty, compare me to the alternative, right? And Democrats sometimes, and I find this to be very admirable as a human, but we are a little cannibalistic about our own, right? It's like nothing's ever good enough, we never do enough, we've not accomplished enough. We've actually done a lot. There's a lot of things to be proud of and to talk about and be proud of. 75% of the country is vaccinated, right? That's a huge accomplishment. There's a bipartisan infrastructure deal that passed that now people are gonna have better access to internet, clean drinking water, bridges, roads. That's hugely important and exciting. There's a lot of things to be proud of that we can be talking about, but I think the contrast piece is pretty pivotal. I would say, the thing that, and this is not, I don't speak for him or work for him anymore, but I would also say that in politics, it is never good when the person who is at the head of your party is not in a good poll numbers. So people should think about how to support that and advocate for the agenda and the policies that that person is advocating for. I'm not saying everybody has to agree with everything. I'm saying be proud of what you've accomplished together and remember that sometimes your fate is going to go with where his poll numbers are. And I think that's an important thing for Democrats to remember. But otherwise, I would just say there's a long time between now and the election. There are things that are against Democrats, including the fact that Democrats are often destroyed when it's a midterm, right? Or walloped or whatever you want to call it. And the fact that the Democrats control the White House, the Senate, and the House. So obviously, running as an opponent, running as a fighter against, isn't sometimes an easier message. But I also think there's a lot for Democrats to be proud of to run on. The contrast is something that everybody should be doing more on. Everybody agrees inflation's a problem. We'll start talking about what we can do about it. That is a key thing. And then, I don't know, the last thing I would say is it's not so bad. We've got a lot of time to go, and elections are moments in time.
Hi, my name's Henry. I'm a first year in the college. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
I'm curious if you feel there was a communications error with Build Back Better or what you would have done differently. And on that question, who is your audience when you're in the briefing room talking about Build Back Better? Is it making it palatable to the public? Or are you trying to speak to Congress people? Because I know there are inside meetings after that.
So it's a very good question. First of all, nobody really knows what Build Back Better is. So that's why we started talking about it as a plan to lower costs. Because costs are on front and center for nearly every person in this country. And whether it's, yes, lowering the cost of gas, but also lowering the cost of childcare, negotiating the cost of prescription drugs, elder care, we kind of adjusted how we talked about this a little bit in, which I think was better. But did we make a mistake earlier on not breaking it down to that? Sure, I mean, hindsight's 20/20, right? The other mistake we made that that the president's talked about was spending too much time in these closed door negotiations and letting that be the dominant storyline. Congress is not popular. People don't like them very much. Not on a personal level, but they're not very popular. And what everybody was seeing was members complaining about what they were or weren't getting, and it just felt like dysfunctional. And the president is best, like many people who are president, because obviously they wouldn't be there if they weren't good at this, engaging with people and talking to people and getting them out in the country, something we talked about late in last year. It took a little bit of time to get there for a range of reasons, COVID, budget, money, schedule, Ukraine, all sorts of things. But that is something I think looking back, we should have done earlier. I think Build Back Better, nobody knows what it is. It's gone through 100 names. The most important thing people can talk about is what it actually does and what you're trying to achieve and how it's going to make people's lives better, which is, sounds obvious when you say it. But looking back, that probably should have been talked about more like that at the beginning.
Thank you.
Hey, thank you for doing this. My name is Daniel Schmidt. I'm a first year here. Gonna pull a bit of a Peter Ducey mode right here.
Okay.
So here it goes. A week ago, after the Roe v. Wade protests were happening in front of the Supreme Court Justice's houses, you said, and I quote, "We certainly can continue to encourage that people protest outside of judges' homes."
Now, never said that.
I'm quoting from.
I said peacefully.
Yeah, sure, peacefully.
That's a key word in there, isn't it?
Peacefully, regardless, they're protesting because they're trying to impact the results. It's a federal crime to protest outside of justices' homes to impact the results. So my question is, do you regret encouraging people to protest outside of justices' homes? Even if it is peaceful, it still is a federal crime.
Well, first, thank you for your question and bring it forward. Let me first say, because I think facts matter and facts are important, I never encouraged anyone to protest. I encourage them to engage peacefully and to do it without violence, without threats, and without intimidation. And that's something I said many, many times and I think is vitally important. It is also true that peacefully protesting in places where it is legal, and it is legal in many places in the country, including outside of some places in the country for sure, is something that is allowed. And I'm not going to tell people, I don't think it's the role of the government to tell people where they can or cannot peacefully protest. If they're breaking the law, of course they shouldn't do that. And I also said that too. Okay. Thank you for your question.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. My name is Chris Phillips. I'm a first year here at the college. My question to you is, now that you've left your post at the White House, what is one thing that perhaps you disagreed with President Biden on, or the way his administration conducted itself, that maybe you could talk about before, whether it be based on policy or how he conducted himself personally? What do you think about that?
I would say, look, I think hindsight, I've said this a number of times, but it's true. You always look back and you think, I wish we would have done this better or differently or what have you. I do think that having him travel earlier and more would have been better for him and better for his first year out in the public, doing events, engaging with people. I do think, as I touched on already, that having meetings and engagements behind closed doors and spending all your time doing that was not the right step to take. I do think he probably should have done more interviews, and he's somebody who has a broad swath of knowledge about a lot of things over a lot of years, whether it's politics or foreign policy. You gotta make the time to do them, and that's often the biggest challenge, because you gotta mark out the time, you gotta do prep, all these things. But I wouldn't recommend working for anyone where you have major, heart-wrenching disagreements with their policies. But there's always things that you look back and you could have done better and differently. It's a healthy thing to do and look back at.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Rohil. I'm a first year undergrad in the college. So my question is, like, the past couple of years, it seems that the trust in the media and institutions has definitely decreased. What do you think, or is there a solution to that? Can we reverse that trend? And if there is, what would that solution be like?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, I think that part of the challenge that you have in government, when you go in the White House, they basically give you a pencil and like a dime, and they're like, go communicate with the world. You know, you don't have any money. And so you rely on earned media, media and institutions like that to communicate with the country. And I will tell you, one of the biggest challenges is that's a imperfect delivery mechanism right now because of what you said. I mean, there's diminishing trust. I don't root for that. I root for the opposite, right? And there's also diminishing readership and viewership, not of everything, but of far too many programs and channels and newspapers, et cetera. How do you rebuild that? I can only speak to in government. I think it takes time, and it takes time to rebuild the trust with the public by presenting facts, by presenting details, by treating people with respect. With the media, I think it might be figuring out how to reach people about the issues they actually care about, you know? I mean, I'm not a media executive or expert, right? But what I do know is that when I was in my last couple of weeks at the White House, I was talking about this a little bit earlier today, you know, we had a major crisis because we didn't have any COVID funding, still don't, right? And we weren't going to be able to plan ahead to purchase vaccines, to purchase tests, to purchase masks, et cetera. That's a major problem for the country. the majority of questions I was getting about COVID in the briefing room were about the gridiron dinner, which is this like grit dinner that happens in a basement where people wear white tie and a bunch of people got COVID. My point is, like, that's not the most important issue that the country is facing. I'm not saying that would solve it alone, but I do think that too often you're having a conversation with yourself. And I would say government officials, myself included, when I was the press secretary, you get into that and you're having that conversation too, and you get a little disconnected from where the country is. And until you can figure out how to bridge that gap, I think you still have a challenge with trust and credibility.
Hi, my name is Elizabeth. I'm a first year student in the college, and I was wondering, you spoke a little bit about role models, and I was wondering who some of those role models were, and additionally, kind of how you decided to go into political communications and why you stuck with it.
Okay, so on the last part, I was not in college thinking I was going to go into political communications. So let me just start there. I worked at an art school for 2 years out of college. I volunteered for the Arlington Democratic Party. I met somebody who was 30, who I thought was very old at the time, who gave me advice on maybe I should do a campaign. And in some ways, I happened into it, right? And I share this because I've never had a five-year plan. I don't have one now. I've never had one. Sometimes I think it closes you off to opportunities and things you don't even think about. But I never thought I would be in political communications. I happened into it because I went and did this campaign, and I can't believe I did this now. I walked into the communications director's office in the Iowa Democratic Party, this lovely person named Mark Daly, and said, I'm a pretty good writer. Can I help you sometime? You know, again, like, I'm embarrassed for myself at this point in time, but it was good. He humored me, and I got to write some things, which he never used because they were terrible, but he was very kind to me. And I got bitten by the bug and thought, this is really interesting, and I'd love to learn how to do this. And I just tried to work for people I could learn from. I have a lot of role models and people I've learned from. I'm just going to talk about Axe, who's over there, who I love. And I use this as, I use him as an example, and I hope this can be a lesson to all of you who have gotten to know him or who you haven't. You can be good and successful in this business. Can I swear here?
You may.
And not be an asshole, you know? You don't have to be a jerk or mean or condescending. You also, whether you're a woman or not, you don't have to, in order to be in the spotlight, you don't have to cut off everybody else's either, right? You don't have to step on fingers. Axe has never done that. And I've always looked at him as somebody who was smart and successful and brilliant. I still call him for advice. I mean, I don't know what I'm unemployed now. He'd be like, I don't have time for you right now. But but in the future, I will still call him for advice. But he always showed me that you could be successful and at the top and also kind and treat people with respect. Whether it is somebody who is the person who is answering the phone when you walk in the White House or it's the President of the United States. And I've always tried to keep that with me. Because I think that is like what I try to do in my best days. But I have lots. I've also had women role models too. I've had lots of people that I've looked up to and learned different things from. And it's not always people who are necessarily in my direct job. I think of people, Michelle Florino. I don't know if you've ever heard of her. She was a high up secretary, defense person. I'm sure maybe one be the Secretary of Defense. I've watching someone like her, and you think this person is smart and so together. You just observe things and take things in from people. It doesn't mean they have to be your mentor who you check in with on a regular basis. Maybe they can be, but mentoring is like dating. You can't like force it, you know, you just have to see how it goes. But I would say you have to just look to people you admire for different reasons and take from people different things you admire about them. Men, women, doesn't matter what they look like, how old they are. Don't limit yourself by that. Just look at the qualities and the way people approach things would be how I would advise you.
I think we have time for about one more. Please do step up.
Ms. Saki, thank you for joining us today, and thank you for your remarks.
Thank you.
As you are no stranger to entering into new positions, oh, my name is Joel. We met earlier.
We met. Nebraska.
Yes, ma'am.
She's in graduate school.
Yes.
Yep. Lived in D.C. for a bit of time.
Wonderful.
I'm introducing her. There you go.
So as you're no stranger to entering into new positions, as many of us in this room, myself included, are gearing up to enter into transitional and transformative phases in our life.
Yeah.
What is one of the most, you know, salient pieces of advice that you would give us into tackling new challenges, walking into new positions, and what would you give to, you know, just, I guess, words of comfort you would give to students getting ready to?
Sure. I don't know if this is words of comfort, but my mother is a therapist, and she has all sorts of crazy sayings. And one of the things she always tells me, she's not the only one who says this, is bite the elephant one bite at a time. And what she means by that is, as you are in the next stage of your career, you don't have to think now of how you're become the Secretary of State. I mean, maybe you will be the Secretary of State one day, right? You have to think about how you're going to approach your next job and learn the most from your next job, right? And do the absolute best you can in your next job, right? Learn everything you can. Do it with a smile. I'm not trying to be overly cheesy here, but like with a good attitude. Ask to do more things. So you don't have to eat the elephant. Just think about the next thing. And sometimes in my last job, you would think about each day or each week. And how you could approach that. The other piece of advice my mother gave me, and I gave to Corrine too, she told me the day before my first briefing to keep my spine stern, or not stern, but stiff, stiffen my spine and keep my feet planted on the ground. And what she meant by that, and this is what I would advise you all on, is that you don't be wavered by people around you. There are amazing people in Washington. There are also some rotten apples, right? You just be you, keep your feet planted on the ground, work hard, bring everything you learned here to it, and it doesn't have to be more complicated. Don't worry about having a map of like 100 networking meetings. I mean, that's important, but like just bite the elephant, keep your spine straight, stern. That's my advice.
Thank you.
Well, I think we've bitten a huge piece of the elephant.
Yeah,
Sarah.
We've had a leg a trunk.
We've elevated mothers as the greatest wisdom givers in the
world.
She's
got a lot.
That was a great thing. So thank you so much for choosing the IOP to be your first place
thank
to
you.
Come talk.
Thank
and thank you,
so
you to
much.
Our audience so much.
Thank you.